Good morning, good morning, good morning. What a morning this is. There's anticipation in the air. We have a baptism today. God is good. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. All the time, right? Our call to worship this morning, our baptism is actually going to be up front right after our first worship song. We want to feel that anticipation today. It comes out of Psalm 100, and it's a psalm for giving grateful praise. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Wow, what an amazing way to start worship, knowing that the Lord is so good and we can give him thanks and praise. So this morning, wherever you are on this faith walk, this journey, will you stand and will you sing with us, My Lighthouse, knowing that our God, he is our lighthouse, always going to shine us home.
Third verse.
In great love will lead me.
You are the peace.
interruption today. We've got a baptism, two baptisms. Are you ready to get baptized?
Yes.
Well, step on forward then. We had a good conversation in my office, did we not?
Yes.
Remember everything we talked about? Good. Can you remind me what we talked about?
Yes.
Talked about Jesus. You were paying attention. Okay. Well, you know, it's a special moment for me because I love your great-grandma. She's real special to me, okay? And actually, you've been named after a very distinguished person, all right? And you, special one, I can see your grandma in you. And I just think that's wonderful. So, we're going to get baptized today. And you know what the Lord said to us? This is what he said. Hear the words of our Lord Jesus. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. So go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And I am with you always, even to the end of the age. You see, in Jesus Christ, God has washed away our sins. That's what the water represents. And you know what he replaces the water with? His Spirit. So you now have the presence of God everywhere you go. So whenever you're in a problem, just start talking to the Lord, and he's going to be there for you. Okay? Baptism is saying, I want to belong to God. And the best thing about baptism is it means that starting now, officially, and through the rest of eternity, which is forever and ever, you have a relationship with God. All right? All right, then. So, in presenting yourselves for baptism, you are making the statement that you belong to Jesus and that you want to study him, know him, love and serve him, and be one of his disciples. So, the question that I'm asking you today is, who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ.
Very well. I'm assuming you trust him and you want to be his disciple and obey his word? All right, then. Congregation, our Lord ordered us to teach those who are baptized. Do you, the people of this church, promise to tell these little ones the good news of the gospel and help them know all that Christ commands and by your fellowship strengthen their family ties with the household of God? If so, answer, we do. Very well. All right. Morgan. Ladies first, okay? Boys first.
No, I nurse it. Yes, you do.
No, I don't.
All right, hold on. We'll figure that one out later, but just so you'll know, it's usually ladies first, all right? So Morgan, Kaylee, Heron, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And I pray that every step you take through life, the Lord Jesus will have you by the hand. And his Spirit will move through your mind and reminding you how much God loves you. And will guide you when you're solving problems, when you're picking friends, when you decide what college to go to, what career to have, when you find a mate to go through life with, and whatever household you live in. The Spirit of Jesus Christ will live with you. As you get baptized, you now belong to Jesus as Lord and Savior. Amen. What do you think? Not bad, huh? Well, let me tell you something. You have the presence of God forever, and that's a special gift. All right? All right. Charles Austin Heron, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And also, I pray that you would become that man of God that is in your family lineage, that you would have the Spirit of Jesus guiding you through life, protecting you, using you, causing that sharp mind and wonderful personality to release the love of Jesus everywhere you go. I pray that God will influence every chapter of your life as well, and so that you're never apart from his blessings and his gifts. As the part of the family of God, you've been baptized into it, and now you'll be a Christian forever. Amen. Now I got these baptismal certificates for you. This is good news. Somebody ever says, have you been baptized? You'll be able to say right here. Okay. All right. Do we have a song? We have a song for you. Baptism so early in the service? Because all your friends wanted to see it. Okay? All right? Well, you're baptized. You're part of the church family. Welcome. Amen.
What an opportunity for us to be able to witness young children step up in their faith, and they want to say before the congregation and their peers that they receive Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Because there's power in the name. So if you are able, let's stand and continue to worship our powerful Lord and Savior.
Who comes, who runs to him?
and that we can just sing out on the name of Jesus, Lord, the name above all names, God. And this morning in our worship, let this be our heart cry prayer to you, Lord.
Our Father, all of heaven rose your name.
Father, it's an exciting week. This is that time when we get Thursday to stop for one purpose, to say thank you to you, to come before you and reflect on all the blessings that we've had and say, Lord Jesus, what a privilege it is to belong to you, to receive all of your blessings, to be under your care, that you have established a personal relationship with us. That's the greatest gift that we have. There is no possession or relationship that matches that intensity. And for us Christians, it's the start of the holiday season, and what a way to start it. by saying thank you. Thank you for entering our lives, for always resourcing us and empowering us and encouraging us and covering us, for answering our prayers, for forgiving our sins, for giving us hope when we're struggling, for reminding us that there's a purpose in our problems. We could go on and on to name the different ways that we are blessed because we belong to you. And today we want to magnify who you are in our lives. You are front and center. You're our hope and our goal. You're the one we cry out to when we have a problem. You're the one we release praises to when we're happy. You're the one we want all of our family and loved ones to be under your covering. It's in your house that we hope to live forever and ever. A hope that's secure because you made that promise to us. We can't out-sin your love. We can't let you down to the point where you let us go. And so, in response to your amazing love, we don't want to let you down. We apologize for getting selfish and petty, for holding grudges, for not forgiving, for forgetting our calling to represent you in this world. Lord, today we'd like to have that attitude of gratitude saturate our heads so that rather than being filled with worries and fears, that we would be filled with confidence and trusting you. Rather than having an attitude against somebody at work or a person that bothers us, that we would extend grace and pray for them. Rather than continually struggle, we'd allow you to go deep down into the crevices of our heart and soul and release your healing. We might need to let go of something somebody said long ago, a past mistake that we've made that continues to be a tool Satan uses to rob us of joy. There might be a past hurt that has hurt us long enough, and it's time to let go, forgive, move on, and never look back. To go forward with our eyes on you. Lord, we come today because we believe in you. We come today because we need you to move in our lives. I know some of us need healing desperately, and we ask in the name of Jesus Christ that you would release that healing upon us. It could be a relational rift, and we need you to put that healing within us, that we would take the first steps to reconcile. We ask that we wouldn't be the same old person, but that Jesus would be seen in our lives, that the love of God would be shared by the way we live. And Lord, as we come to this quiet moment, I think I'd like to give us all the assignment of listing out our blessings privately before you now. Lord, somehow when we count our blessings, puts our problems into perspective. You tell us, bring them to you and you will be our Lord and Savior. So we bring them to you. But today is all about saying thank you. You really are a beautiful God. We couldn't create anybody more incredible than who you already are. And so today we embrace you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Heavenly Father. And we bless you. In the name above all names we pray. Amen.
Woo! Well, what a great morning to be in church. It might be a little wet and cold outside, but it's warm inside. And you know, we're so glad that you're with us, whether you're a first-time guest, or maybe you're a recurring visitor, or maybe your family just coming home. I want to point out the seat backs in front of you. It is a getting to know you card. This is for anybody. We encourage you to fill these out. Maybe you have a praise report or a prayer request. If you drop it in the offering plate as it comes by this morning, our pastor, he's going to connect with you or the staff during the week. We really want to know what's going on in your lives. Speaking of getting connected, we do have the white friendship registry that's on the inside aisles. If you wouldn't mind pulling those out and just quickly signing your name, we find out who's been in church and you all find out who you're worshiping alongside of. There's so much going on in our family here at church, and we want to get you connected into what's happening. So speaking of praise reports, I want to point out we have a stewardship update. 124 commitment cards were turned in, totaling $533,000. So that's a praise report. We can clap for that. But now I have a prayer request. My prayer request is, if you haven't had that opportunity to fill out your pledge card, maybe God's stirring in your heart. We have to fill up the gap to make our year next year. So you can see it's $247,500 yet to go. I know our God is faithful. And if he's moving on your heart, I want to encourage you to fill that out. You can go online as well. There are many opportunities. We have so much happening, but today I want to point out, we have a town hall meeting. It's right at noon, so some of us I know during this service, maybe you've gone to breakfast right away, so it's a perfect opportunity to come back. You're going to find out about what's happening and the vision for our church and the new facility. If that does not work out that time, 7 o'clock tonight, we have another one. We really want you to get connected. Like I said, there's so much happening in the life of our family. We have a Thanksgiving service at the Catholic Church on Tuesday. We have Savoring the Season. Now, you don't want to miss this. This is when we cook for you and we say thank you. That's going to be on December the 2nd coming up. We also have our first Sunday in Advent is next Sunday. I don't know about many of you, but that's like, wow, that just happened quick. And I'm looking for some volunteers this coming Sunday from 11 to 4, right here in our sanctuary. We are going to magically, miraculously turn this into Christmas. And I need some volunteers with some muscles, because we do hang a lot of garland. And we're looking forward to doing this together. We have life groups, men's conversation. Looks like you're having a barbecue on the 1st. That looks like a lot of fun. So you don't want to miss that. We also have an adult Sunday school, and that happens during this time, but just in case you are ever interested. Like I said, there is so much happening in the life of our family. Missions, Operation Christmas Child, your boxes are due today. So please make sure, maybe if you're sitting on the counter, run home and grab it. Our youth, we are having our Monday, our potluck. So youth, remember to bring a side. You want to bring something for that. There's so much happening. It's exciting. Check out the calendar. And like I say, every week, possibly you're not knowing how to get connected. And if you're going through a rough time during this season, we do have our Soul Care ministry. And you can connect with them. You can call the church office. You could even write that on the Getting to Know You card for right now. I need to speak with someone. We have Stephen ministers that will come alongside you, knowing that you're never alone. For more information about what's happening in the life of our family, check us out on our website. And I'm going to take an opportunity right now. I'm assuming this is the church that is social media savvy. So check in on Facebook right now. It's the opportunity before Pastor preaches. Pull out those phones. Check in on Facebook. Let everyone know where we're worshiping today.
Offering right now, it's an opportunity to say thank you, God. It's an opportunity to do thanks living, where we put God's blessings into circulation, and we find the lost, we heal up the broken, we care for families that have been devastated by life. We've got mission outreaches across the oceans. We've got a strong hand reaching down 192. We're trying to tell as many kids as possible about Jesus. There's so many different fingers through our ministry that are stretched out so that the touch of God might be released. So as the offering plates circulate, let's participate with God. And remember, you know, this is how He touches the world, through us. Amen. Thank you for that cool song. All right, our scripture lesson today comes from Luke chapter 17, verses 11 through 19. Hear the word of God. Now, on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. And as he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. And they stood out at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." And when he saw them, he said, "Go show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. And he threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. And Jesus asked, "Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" And then he said to him, "Rise and go. Your faith has made you well." This is the word of the Lord. Well, it's time to get ready for Thanksgiving. I told my wife we needed to get the smoke alarm fixed before Thanksgiving. She asked why, and I said, "Well, how else are we going to know the turkey's ready?" So if anybody has a free spot at the table, this one woman had to pick up a prescription at the Walmart, and it was one of those typical busy afternoons compounded by the fact that it was raining, and she was in a hurry looking for a parking spot, and so she began to pray, "Lord, could you make a parking spot open for me?" And no sooner did these words leave her lips, and the car right in front of the front entrance started to pull out. And so she said, "Never mind, God, something just opened up." How often do we cry out to God in desperation over an issue, and as soon as something opens up, we continue in our mindset, I'll take it from here, Lord, basically saying, "God, I don't need you anymore." And the word "thank you," it's just too infrequent in our society. I know most of us are familiar with the traditional Thanksgiving story in 1621, where William Bradford at the Plymouth Rock proclaimed a day of thanks to celebrate the survival of the Pilgrims during their second year in the New World. However, most don't know that the first American Thanksgiving took place 11 years before. It was in the winter of 1610 at Jamestown. They had settlers, 409 of them arrived, and they were down to 60. And the survivors prayed for help, and it unexpectedly arrived in the form of a ship filled with food and supplies from England. And immediately they stopped and had a Thanksgiving service. They needed to thank God for providing. And I found this interesting because they had just seen 349 of their loved ones die. But what was their priority? It was giving thanks. And I think sometimes as Americans, we tend to overlook how blessed we are. Remember our missionary from Kenya. She pointed out that Africans eat 3 times a week. It's quite different than the way we live. And maybe that's the curse of materialism. It keeps our minds off of our blessings and focuses us on the more to be had. Okay, Satan distracts us from the blessings and points out that everything's wrong. Here are the reasons why you're not happy yet. And too often our Thanksgiving is limited to merely comparing to what other people have. We're thankful if we have more than somebody else, or we don't have as much pain as another person. And really, friends, gratitude is the source of all the other Christian virtues. When you have a thankful heart, it spills out into your kindness and patience and faithfulness and goodness and everything else. It's when we're not inclined to be thankful that we drift into that entitlement mentality. A little boy was handed an orange by a man, and his mother chided him. "What do you say?" And the boy thought for a moment and handed it back to the man and said, "Peel it." Entitled. And really, when we don't say thank you, what happens is our hearts grow callous and we become prideful. And it's here in our text that we see a parallel with those in our society who call out to Jesus for mercy, but it's from a distance. And what's amazing about God is he makes himself accessible no matter the proximity. Like the 10 lepers, God will help you out wherever you are. All you have to do is call on him. This is important to hear because many live under the impression that we have to get our lives together so that we can have an audience with God. No. Psalm 34:6, this poor man cried out to the Lord and God saved him from all his troubles. And I want you to notice that the 10 lepers ask God for a healing, but the words they use are, "Have mercy on us." You see, mercy is getting what we don't deserve. And friends, I want to remind you all, we do not earn things from God. We live at the hand of his mercy, which he lavishes upon us. You see, leprosy was misinterpreted as a curse from God. So on a deeper level, they're asking God, "Do you still hate me?" And by the way, all of us initially come to Jesus with the cry, "Have mercy on me." And once you enter into that relationship, once you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, friends, the prayer changes. You have received mercy. You've become part of the family. And now when we pray, there is authority and power to pray and see things happen and watch the hand of God move. And we can change this world as the Spirit moves forth on our prayers. I think sometimes we're so tentative. You can step into your prayer and release it with confidence because you're asking God, who loves you, to move as his Spirit guides you. You're no longer an outsider. You're an insider in God's family, and we're supposed to be about the family business. Well, you'll notice that Jesus said, "Go show yourself to the priests." This was an Old Testament requirement from Leviticus. If God was to heal you, you were to show yourself to the priests in order to re-enter society. Which implies, first of all, that healings were available back then from God. Exodus 15:26, the Lord says, "I am your healer." And I think this would be a challenging situation for the priests because they're all in alignment and strategizing on how to destroy Jesus. Then all of a sudden, 9 lepers show up. "Hi, we used to be lepers, but we just got healed." "How'd you get healed?" "By Jesus." "Jesus? Well, he's not ordained." And I could hear one of the lepers saying, "Yeah, but doesn't Isaiah say something about the Messiah will heal all our infirmities?" And do you notice it was as they were going, they were healed. This is important. Stepping forth in faith. It was a requirement in order to receive what they wanted from God. And no doubt there was the thought, "Why go show myself to the priest? Nothing's happened yet." Maybe there was even this discussion among the realists and the practical folks. You know, I mean, why go show ourselves to the priest? And then finally, one of them said, "Let's just do what he said." Kind of like the conversation in 2 Kings 5. There was a military leader, Naaman. He comes to the prophet Elisha. He has leprosy. And the prophet says, "Go wash yourself in the Jordan River." And he gets mad. "The Jordan River, that's a dirty river. There's better rivers where I come from." And his servant says, "Look, if he would have told you to go do something great, you would have done it. So why don't you just do what he said?" And he gets healed. And by the way, he then returned to offer gifts of gratitude. And I'm going to argue that we ought to be that person who persuades others to do what Jesus says. In our society today, too many have the wrong impression of God. We see him as an angry God waiting to zap us, or a God who demands too much and wants to take away all our fun in life. Lots of people today just don't think he's real. And you and I have the calling to clarify the truth about God, to point out that He is merciful to everyone, especially sinners, that He cares about us and can change our circumstances, that He wants to free us from a sin-dominated lifestyle and mindset. Friends, you and I have the lofty purpose to change earth and heaven. That's what's available when we let Jesus have access to our lives. And I want you to notice the 10 lepers. They didn't confess their sins before they received their healing. They weren't responsible for their healing. God was. They weren't sin conscious first. They were Jesus conscious. They were aware of Jesus and His capabilities. Their focus wasn't on them and their limitations. It was on Jesus. And Jesus wanted them to exercise their faith in what He was capable of doing for them. And really, it's the same for us. It's as you and I take steps in God's direction that we start to understand His nature and we start to see His power released in our lives. Too often we hold back instead of stepping into it. It's as we go forth in His name that Christianity happens. And really, the message for us is don't look at your circumstances. Don't look at your condition. Don't look at the doctor's prognosis or the test results. Those are just circumstantial evidence that the accuser tries to use against us to wear us down and to freeze us with fear and doubt. Don't look to anything else except your God and what His Word has to say about you. Really, His Word has the final say in every situation. If you have a need, look to Him and His promises. I remember how Jesus handled Satan. He pointed out to the devil the Word of God. It is written. This is what we live off. I wrote out just one cool verse from Isaiah 45:2. I will go before you and make the crooked places straight. Okay. Just one of the many promises. You know, I was wondering, it says, as they went, when did it happen? Was it the first step? Was it the 100th step? I mean, every step would have been steeped with the possibility of a miracle. It was probably as they were pondering the miraculous power of Jesus that caused it to be released. And again, sometimes we don't understand God. We step out in faith and all kinds of obstacles arise, and then we start to question, did I really hear from God? Shouldn't it be easier? And friends, yes, He is a God of order, but you know what? He also likes to surprise us. You know, and while we might not comprehend His ways, all we have to do is follow, and He will do what He wants to do. And let me remind you, He longs to be gracious to us. Blessing us is part of belonging to Jesus. But sometimes He'll use our challenges to bring spiritual fruit out of us or for somebody else. Every day that you and I exercise faith, it brings us one day closer to obtaining God's best for our lives. Well, all 10 lepers were healed that day. One mass miracle, everybody healed from head to toe. And what this meant was they were spared a death sentence, where their body would literally rot away. This would usually happen over a span of 9 years. This gross odor and all this pus would start to just flow from your body, and then deformities would start and body parts would fall off until finally the victims would collapse and just waste away. That's what they got spared. 9 Jews, people of the covenant, 1 Samaritan, despised by the Jews. And here's where the story gets intriguing, because it was the spiritual outcast, the one who doesn't know the truth about God, who doesn't have an inherent relationship with God, that deviates from the religious group and returns to Jesus to say, thank you. You know, he was shouting glory to God, kneeling in gratitude. He couldn't thank Jesus enough. And Jesus seemed surprised. We're not 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? He clearly expected the others to show gratitude as well. 10 people received God's benefits. 10 people were touched by the love of God. 9 of them kept going and never looked back. This puzzled Jesus. They shunned the one who restored them, blessed them, saved them from a death sentence. Maybe they were wrapped up in their new gift, freedom to go home and be reunited with their families and re-enter society. No doubt they would thank God next time they made their way to the temple. And yet they neglected the one who was responsible for giving them life, kind of like the lady with the parking space. Oh, never mind, I won't be needing you anymore. There's a passage in Jeremiah. It says, my people have forgotten me days without number. I wonder how often we make that mistake. And I wonder why they didn't return. I wonder if one waited to see if the cure was real. Or another might have waited to see if the cure would last. One thought, I'll get around to thanking Jesus. Another sneered, you know, it wasn't fair that I was stricken with leprosy in the first place. One possibly thought, you know, actually, Jesus really didn't do anything. We could argue that the other 9 were merely doing what they were told, being obedient, go show yourself to the priests. And I could hear them arguing with the Samaritan, hey, where are you going? Hurry up. And he yelled back, I'm going back to say thank you. And that was their moment. Is it all about me? Or am I going to allow my life, my schedule, my agenda to be inconvenienced by responding to God with gratitude? You know, the reason that he turned around was to show gratitude and offer worship. For him, it was the only adequate response. Going to the priest, that was for the 9's benefit. We get to re-enter society. Turning back to Jesus, that was for the Lord's benefit, to let him know just how worthy he was to the Samaritan. And friends, I want you to know worship is the main thing we do. In fact, in John 4, it tells us that God seeks worshipers. And God has called his church to give glory to him above everything else. And I'm sure this healed leper was going to go follow through and see the priest, but he realized he had a higher calling to tend to first. He wanted to make sure he showed the Lord how much he appreciated him. And it's in this extra interaction that something special took place for the Samaritan. Remember, everybody stayed at a distance and received a blessing from God, but they never had the face-to-face encounter with their healer. You know, lepers were those eerie people that you would see standing on a horizon 100 paces away from the non-infected people. To be a leper meant you had no intimacy with anyone, no friendships. You were isolated. You were an outcast. And so what did? They settled on a distant gift when something greater was available to them, a relationship. You see, beyond the physical pain of the disease was the emotional aspect. Because when you were unclean, it meant you had to cover your face. And the face being hidden represented that no form of intimacy could be known to them. In the Hebrew tradition, the face represented how you knew somebody. Like when God said Moses knew him face to face, you and I are told to seek God's face, that God's presence is expressed in the terms of his face for us. You know, the great theologian Al Pacino, he once said, I asked God for a bike, but I know God doesn't work that way. So I stole a bike and I asked for forgiveness. And too often we think of God's grace as some kind of a spiritual substance that he dispenses on his people. Here's your grace. But actually, it's not a thing and it's not stuff. God gives us himself. That's the grace. We don't deserve to be in his presence. But that's what he gives us. That's what grace means. His presence. You know, the first time the leper came to Jesus, he received the physical blessing. The second time, he has a personal encounter with God. Spiritual blessing. And friends, it was through that encounter he moved from being an outsider to part of the family. The second effort to seek out God resulted in a lifetime blessing. The words Jesus used are made whole. And the Hebrew word sozo, it's all-encompassing. You know, God now adopted him that day. He became entitled to every benefit that was provided by Jesus from the cross. He now has kingdom possibilities. This is something the other nine missed. The other nine, they went back to the daily grind, and they didn't have the supernatural empowerment that was available through a relationship with Jesus. Well, let me close things up. How did the leper know to turn to Jesus? You know, earlier in the Gospels, there's this story of this one leper who comes to Jesus and said, "If you are willing, you can make me clean." And Jesus said, "I am willing," and he touched him and said, "Be cleansed." And I wonder if that leper went back to the other lepers and said, "You're not going to believe it. I found a way out of this place." And really, friends, the word got out, and you know how it gets out? The people who've been touched by Jesus, the ones who've had a personal interaction with him, the ones who've called on him who have been answered. I guess I'm talking about us. We need to get the word out about what Jesus can do for the people around us. You know, there was a medical missionary. He shared that the region he served in struggled with progressive blindness. People would just start to go blind. And he developed a treatment that cured it. And the people were happy to be saved from blindness, but they never said thank you because they didn't have that phrase in their dialect. Instead, they would say, "I will tell your name." And wherever they went, they would tell the name of the missionary who cured their blindness. They eagerly proclaimed what they received from him. And isn't that what we're supposed to do? Proclaim his name. Have you shared his name with anybody lately? You know, this whole ISIS terrorist threat, it's causing lots of us to wonder as we circulate out into the malls and it's going to be Black Friday and we go to crowded areas, am I safe? What if something happens? Well, I know that you're all ready for eternity, but all of us have friends, family members that might be living at a distance from Jesus right now. And I'm going to challenge you to make a life-changing difference in somebody else's world and tell them about our Lord. And I'm going to give you an example of how to do it this Thanksgiving. Hey, what are your thoughts on ISIS? Are you scared? Yeah, me too. Well, do you mind if I go religious on you for just a moment? You know, it's Thanksgiving, and I am thankful for your presence in my life. In fact, I want to be in your presence for the rest of eternity. And you know what? I'm a Christian, and I believe that God is real. I believe that God has communicated to us through Jesus. I believe that he's available to move in our lives right now, and I want you to have that same friendship with God. So tell me, what are your religious beliefs? How hard would that be? Is that offensive? Did you hurt anybody's feelings? All you did is tell them how much you enjoy their friendship. It's that easy, friends, for you and I to open up the dialogue and watch the Holy Spirit move. I mean, in the end, all of us are like the 10 lepers. We were outcasts from God's kingdom. We were on our way to certain death. But then we had a life-changing encounter with Jesus. Something to be thankful for? Amen. I want you to go forth and have a happy Thanksgiving. You set the tone at the table, whether you set the table or are invited to the table. Make sure that we bring up what we're thankful for. Bring God into the Thanksgiving meal. Amen. Amen.